Hey everyone! In past videos, we talked about SPI, I2C, and serial pins for GPIO on the Flipper Zero. And this allows us to communicate with lots of different devices. In the past, I talked about how you could use the Dolphin board to access SPI, I2C, and serial as well. But sometimes you come across a custom protocol that the Flipper doesn't support, such as the lights in the flipboard or in your backlight modification if you've done one of those. Those devices usually have a data sheet that explains all the different timing. In today's video, we're going to learn how to create different signals like the ones you see behind me. This video isn't a coding video, it's just covering the concepts. In a few weeks, I'll make a video that talks about the code we need to implement on the Flipper Zero. Let's get started. First, I wanted to say I'm still learning. The microcontroller reference manual is about 1,500 pages, and over 300 of those pages talk about things that apply to signals and timing. So some of the information I teach today, there may be a more efficient way we learn later, but this is going to teach you the basics behind how to make different signals. The first waveform we're going to look at is called toggle. And so you can see that we have a high and then a low and a high and a low. And so with toggle, what happens is we toggle between the high state and the low state at some duration. In this case, I'm saying every 4 units of time, we're going to toggle. This 4 could be whatever number you want. I'm just choosing that as an example. Next, we have pulse width modulation. And this is also known as PWM. And so for the first 2 units of time, we're going to be on, and then the remainder of that we're off. And then the first 2 were on, and the remainder is off. So on each of these graphs, I'm only showing the numbers that you need to be able to create the signal. And you could see that we could actually implement this previous case if we just said we wanted to be on for 4 and then off for the remainder. And then on for 4 and off for the remainder. And if our time was 8, we'd have 4 on and then 4 off, just like the above sequence. Next, we have pulse width modulation plus direct memory access. And our direct memory access is changing our duty cycle. So the duty cycle up here was 2. It was 25% of the time we're on. So that's called the duty cycle. And so on this one, you can see that we're always pulses of 8, pulses of 8. But our duty cycle is changing. So here we were using 2 and then turning off. And then here we use direct memory access to change that register and make it a 4 instead. And we were 4 and then we were off. And then here we changed it with direct memory access to a 6 and then we were off. And then 3 and then we were off. So using direct memory access, you can change any register, any of these settings, and including GPIO pin output and all kinds of stuff. But we're using this to change our duty cycle. Okay, now we have toggle plus direct memory access, and our direct memory access is changing the duration of our toggle. So we're on for 2, and then we toggle, and then direct memory access, we change the value to a 6, and then we toggle, and then direct memory access, we change the value to a 4, and we toggle, and then we change the value to a 2 and toggle and 6, 5, 2. So here we're able to do an arbitrary waveform using toggle plus direct memory access. Another common technique called bit banging, and basically what you do is you output a high on the pin and then you sleep for 2 units of time, and then you output a low on the pin and you sleep for 6 units of time, and then you output a high and you sleep for 4 units of time, etc. So bit banging is another technique that accomplishes the same thing. The disadvantage is that with bit banging, your process could potentially be interrupted by some other higher priority process. And with timers, you basically send all the information to the timer and it's offloaded. And if you get interrupted, it'll still send the signal with the right timing. Okay, so this last one we're going to look at is pulse width modulation and direct memory access. And this time our direct memory access is changing our repetition counter and our mode, whether or not the signal is enabled or disabled. So this is how the infrared signals get sent. So there's this high frequency, which is, it's going to be 2 on and then 3 off. That's the, you know, the duty cycle is 40%. So this is 5 units of time. 2 of them is going to be on and the remainder will be off. 2 on, remainder off, 2 on, remainder off, 2 on, remainder off. But then we're using DMA to, we're still counting, but we don't put the signal on the GPIO pin. So we just get this low. And then we're able to get a high and a low. And then with DMA, with the repetition counter, we're actually able to say we want 3 repetitions. And so it'll do this signal, and this signal, and give us those 3 pulses. And then we could say we want 1 repetition, and this time we want it to be off instead, or 1 repetition and on instead. And so this way you're able to modulate a high frequency carrier with a low frequency data. Next, let's take a look at how the Flipper Zero actually does the counting. Okay, the Flipper Zero has a 64 megahertz clock, so it's outputting a signal 64 million times a second. We can take that signal and divide it by 1, 2, or 4. I typically choose 1, which means that this output is also 64 megahertz. If you divided it by 2, then the output would be 32 megahertz, or if you divide it by 4, you'd have 16 megahertz. Our prescaler is, so we take that output, and it's how many times we want to count those pulses until we send out an output signal. So if you were to count 64 pulses, this output would be at 1 megahertz. And if you counted 640 pulses, this output would be at 100 kilohertz. Hopefully that makes sense. This starts at 0. They count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that would be a, for if you wanted every 10 pulses, you would put a value of 9 here. So in the example before, you'd put a value of 63 here for a 1 megahertz, or 639 for 100 kilohertz. And then finally, that output, I'm just calling clock tick. There's no official name for it, but it just helps to be able to talk about how fast things go. And so this is the range if you're using a div 1. And you can see that lets us go super fast, 15 nanoseconds per pulse, down to fairly slow, like 1 millisecond per pulse. So that's how fast a unit of time is. And in timers, we can say we want them to count up or we can want them to count down. There's some other modes too, but we're not going to talk about that. And so you saw in the previous thing where we were talking about toggle and having that event happen every 4. So we've decided how fast we want the events to happen, somewhere between 15 nanoseconds to 1 millisecond. And then we would say we want to count up. And whenever we hit that 4th pulse, we want to have the event happen. And this starts at 0, so it would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. So we're going to actually want to put a 3 in here to get a pulse every 4 times. For that pulse width modulation sample, the width was 8. So you would put a 7 here. So it goes 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And that event is the end of our pulse width modulation. Then we also have channels, and there's multiple channels per timer. And a channel has this output compare. And it also, there's another name for a channel, which is channel with the N. And the N is just the opposite of the channel. So if the channel was going to be high, the opposite, the N version would be low. And when the channel is going to be low, the opposite would be high. So it's another channel you can have access to. We have whether or not it's enabled or disabled. We saw when it was disabled, we just got that low. And then you have your mode, which is in toggle or pulse width modulation. There's some other modes, but we're not going to talk about those today. And then the polarity is, does it start off with the high pulse or does it start off with the low pulse and then go high? And then there's also how does it behave in its idle state when you're not actually sending toggles or pulse widths. And then this compare is only used in the pulse width modulation. Again, for the toggle, we just put the value 3 here to get a signal every 4th event in toggle. Or using DMA, we would keep editing this value to get different lengths of toggle. For pulse width modulation, like I said, we put a 7 here to have it have the pulse width happen every 8 times. But then down here is where we would put a value of 1 if we wanted 0, 1, which is 2. So we put a value of 1 to say 0, 1 should be high, and then the rest up until we get to our 7 would be low, and then 0, 1 would be high, and the rest would be low. And again, we used DMA to change the duty cycle, which is this number, as well. And if this signal is going still too fast for you, then instead of 4, we could have used 40 and 80 or whatever. And then don't forget to always subtract 1 because you're starting at 0. But hopefully that makes sense. As I mentioned before, I'm still learning, but my understanding is that we can use alternate functions in GPIO to tie our pins to the output states of different counters. On the flipper, you can see that the second pin is A7 and the third pin is A6 and so on. On here, we have the pin number like 1, 2, 3, and then A7 or pin 3 is A6. For each of these, we have the alternate function for GPIO along with the timer and the channel or the channel N that's required to tie into that alternate function. So when the flipboard was made for the RGB LEDs, we chose a value of PC3. And if we look on pin C3, you'll see that there actually isn't a timer we can use to control those lights. So the solution was to use direct memory access. And with direct memory access, we're writing a set or a reset value to the GPIO pin, and you can do this to any GPIO pin that you would like. And the only disadvantage is that that direct memory access code only triggers at the end of the cycle. So works great with toggle, but in pulse width modulation, you're only gonna get it at the end of the pulse, not when it's transitioning from high to low. At least I don't know how to do that yet, if there is a way. So hopefully that makes sense. You can see that if you're able to know ahead of time, this is actually a really good common timer to use. The other challenge is the sub-gigahertz radio uses some of these timers and infrared uses some of these timers. So it's good to understand what else is happening while you're using your GPIO device. So you can pick a timer such as maybe timer 16 or something that's not in use and choose that as your design. Typically what happens if you don't is you, again, like in the case of using toggle instead of pulse width modulation, we have to have 2 bytes of data, 1 byte representing the on time and 1 byte representing the off time instead of 1 byte of data. So it's twice the memory on the flipper 0 to use toggle versus something like pulse width modulation. So always try to use pulse width modulation if you're able to. Now you know the basic concepts needed to generate different signals on the flipper 0. Please like and subscribe. In a couple of weeks, I'll release a coding video that uses the techniques we learned to implement all the different signals on the flipper 0. Please also join my Discord server for giveaways and more information.